Well, hi there. I think you already know my trusty Black & Decker drill. It's made in 1969 and it's from my granddad. I took it apart in one of my videos and re-greased it, but really wasn't actually necessary. It's an indestructible piece of machinery. I really love it and I wouldn't trade it for any other drill. And when I moved the workshop to our basement at our house, of course we also dug through all the junk that my granddad had in his basement, and the parts you see here are actually for a circular saw which is driven by this very drill. So this here obviously is the table, and here are the mounting feet for pieces. And this contraption here is a device to clamp the drill underneath, and to the drill will be mounted a circular saw blade and a, well, dust cover, mostly a protective guard, I guess. He has no idea how this thing all went together. The last time he used it was maybe 60 years ago, but a long time ago. So I kind of think I've got the hold of it. So this here is the clamping part, and the drill would go in here. Now I don't know which way exactly, I think this way, yeah, this way. And you can see these tangs here, they engage on this pattern in here. Now the problem here is, no matter how I put it, you cannot just simply use some kind of drive pin and chuck it in the drill chuck to put the blade on, because the blade is supposed to sit here, not here. So what I'm assuming is that some time ago they had like a bolt with a register machined on it to fit this saw blade, and it would get mounted in this spindle, and you would have to remove the drill chuck for that. I do not know when the drill chuck has been apart the last time, or off this machine the last time. Certainly has been used, this thing, but doesn't look like a whole lot. So I'm thinking it's going to be pretty tough getting this off. There's no spindle lock on this thing. So the only thing I saw on the internet was to chuck up an Allen wrench in the chuck and hit it with a hammer. Supposedly that's enough to free it up. I'm a little skeptical, but you know, there's no other way than giving it a try. So the chuck came off really easily. There's actually oil on these threads, so I guess they must have taken care of it. I goofed up a little bit, because when you look at this, you can see, well, maybe you can't, but it says oil on here and an arrow. So that tells me that this thing is supposed to turn. Alright? And it's going to be mounted like this, and it has a register on here onto which the saw blade fits. So I'm assuming it would just be enough to, oh, no, it isn't. Well, maybe I'm not all that much of an idiot. Okay, so yeah, you can see that. This amount of thread stick out is too little to be enough to grip in the spindle. So what I was going to tell you was that it might have been enough to just take the chuck as is and use it as a mounting bolt, but apparently it's not, so I didn't buy the die for nothing. The thread on here, I expected it to be some kind of M10x1 or M12x1 standard fine thread, like for the usual drill chucks, but it's not. It's 3/8-24, which is imperial, and it's a standard fine thread. I bought a die so we can make the bolt, and now I'm going to see how exactly this is going to be mounted. So really all we need to make the bolt is the width of this entire part, and that is... yes, that's close. 8 millimeters. So we need 8 millimeters plus length of thread, and I'll take what is here, and this thread is 10 millimeters long. So we'll make the threaded part of the bolt 18 millimeters. I guess what would make the most sense would be using a regular bolt with the hex already on there and just machine off the threads to expose bare metal or round metal, and then machine the new thread onto there. But unfortunately, the biggest size bolts I have are M10, and to get to a circular piece or to machine off the threads, you will need to remove it until it's 8.6 millimeters in diameter. Since our 3/8 thread needs a diameter of round about 9.4 millimeters, I cannot use them, so we'll have to start from scratch. This is my treasure of raw material, and I was close to using one of these because they have a nice shoulder, so that we could use this part to make this the square. I decided on a square because it's less work and easier to index, and use this for the thread. But then I noticed, hey, there's some silvery stains around here. So I assume that this ring is silver soldered onto here, and that's what doesn't make it that useful as a bolt. So I guess I'll be using this. This is from a rotating ball handle. So the handle goes on here, and usually what fails is this little divot here. There is a spring on there which keeps the grip from detaching, and that's usually where it fails. So there is tons of these parts around landing in the scrap, and I just take them because they're valuable for occasions like these. Thank you. So the bolt is made, so there is nothing left but a test fit. So that's working. The next thing to do will then be assembling the entire saw. I suppose this could also be used as a handheld saw. As you can see, it has a sliding mechanism for the cover, so that you could also use it by hand. Okay, I certainly need to remake that bolt because, let me show you. You can see how much that is oscillating, so I assume I didn't cut the thread straight. But other than that, the concept is working, which is good. And, you know, the saw blade is incredibly dull, but it's enough to cut wood. So, I'll have to do a little bit of tuning on that, remake the bolt, and it should be perfect for operation.